Grace and peace be multiplied to you through the knowledge of God and our Lord Jesus Christ. Welcome. Today we'll be looking at Christ the Eternal King. Christ the King, eternal, immortal, invisible, the only wise God. We're going to be looking at the kingship of the Lord Jesus Christ. He's not just our Savior, he's not just our Redeemer, he's not just our High Priest, he's also our King. Someone will ask, what does a king could not? I'm sure we all know what a king could not. A king essentially is to take care of his people. It's a king. It signifies a kingdom, a king with a domain. He has authority over that area. So Christ is not only our High Priest, he's also our King. God has made his Son to be everything to us in his salvation, in his organic salvation. We're looking at his kingship. There's the priesthood of Christ, there's the kingship of Christ, and the office of the prophet, the priest, and the kings were three different offices in the Old Testament, but we see that all these offices are just pointing the realities in the person of Christ. God in Christ is our King. God in Christ is our King. God, the person of Christ, as Hebrews 1:8 says, the Father says to the Son, your throne, O God, is forever and ever. His throne in heaven. And yet he's still a king on this earth here, because the earth is the Lord and the fullness thereof and they that dwell in it. The Bible is essentially about Christ as King coming to, or inviting men to be made the expression of his kingdom on earth. The whole Bible is about Christ and a king and his kingdom. Christ the King and his kingdom, so that the kingdom of Christ will have its influence over the affairs of men. Essentially, he's looking for vessels, human vessels, who will be the expression of his kingdom on earth. Of course, for these fallen human vessels to be made his expression, they will have to come into his kingdom, go through the process of sanctification, transformation, and conformation to his image, so that we can reflect and express his image. Christ is the Melchizedek, the priest king, the king that combines the office of the priest and the king, and also the prophethood as well. So is the reality of Melchizedek, essentially. Hebrews 7 is the reality of Melchizedek. Is a priest king, meaning that the king of righteousness, the king of peace. The King of Peace, the King of Righteousness. Christ is the real Melchizedek. We have a different video in that. Priest essentially signifies purity, the relationship of God to the people. The priests do maintain that, taking the sacrifices from the people, ministering to God, and God showing his kindness and his mercy to the people. Kingship, we could say, in essence, is the civil life of the people. This is someone who is now bringing the principles of the kingdom of God, the ways of God, to make sure there is law and order, to make sure that the people are protected. So the king signifies power and authority. And as it relates to Christ, priest signifies the purity of us, our righteousness. Kingship signifies the authority he has given to us and has made us king and priest on this earth. There is no king like Christ. And we could say that almost every good office we find on the earth here is an allegory. The reality of it is Christ. The office of the president, the prime minister, the king, the queen, of any leadership position essentially is a shadow. The reality is in the person of Christ. There's a difference between the kingship of Christ and the kingship of men. And the difference is clear. So let's take some of the differences. First, this is a king who dwells in his people. There is no king under heaven that dwells in his people. There is no leader, there's no president that dwells in his subject. Only in the kingdom of God. And that is only by the power and the omnipotence of God himself. That Christ, our king, is not just a remote king to us. It's not a distant king to us. It's a king that is dwelling and living in our hearts. For we to live is for Christ to live. A king who became a ransom for his people. That is, he showed the love he has for his people by offering himself as a sacrifice before deity. So this is a king that was made a ransom for his people. And essentially, as Bible scholars tell us, and we go through the four gospels, we say that there are four aspects of Christ being revealed. Matthew tells us about the king savior. We have the slave savior. We have the man savior. And we have also the God savior, which is John. So essentially, there are different aspects of the gospel that they face. The central theme of those gospels were revealing. Matthew talks about him as a king. So he is a king that became a ransom for us, his people. We do not have a distant king. Every king is distant from his people, and essentially, not physically. Once they go to their house, they're in their house, the king is in the palace. And many times the king is not even going through, if they are going through famine or weaknesses, he might probably not even know, except if it gets to an aggravated level. Not such with our king, because he dwells in our heart. We do not have a remote king. And the King in heaven is the King in our hearts here on earth as believers in Christ Jesus. Our King abides in us. Our King lives in us. Our King dwells in us. This is a pride we can hold on and we boast in the Lord that our King is not distant from us. Our risen Lord is not remote to us. He lives inside of us. So our King, the Lord Jesus Christ, abides in us as we abide in Him. The life of our King is in us. There is no King like Christ. There is no King like Christ. There is no King that His life is in His subject. The life of our King has become our very life in the new creation. So the life of our King is inside of us. What a joy to this miracle. What a joy. A King who puts His Spirit in His people. There is no other King that puts His Spirit in His people. It's not possible. They can't even do it. But this is a King, the Lord Jesus Christ. And that's part of the reason He redeemed us. So by baptizing us into His body, we receive His Spirit. And His Spirit begins to now make our life His expression here on earth. What a joy. A King who makes His citizens partakers of His nature. The divine nature. Our King has made us partakers of the divine nature. Of the holiness of God. The love of God has been shed abroad in our heart. The glory, the wisdom, the power, the fullness of the God. That we dwell in our King. Our King has made us partakers of that nature. What a joy to the kingship of Christ. A King who is the light in His citizens. There's darkness everywhere. The King we have is the light of the world. And as citizens of the kingdom of God, He becomes the very light in our life so that our light will shine among men. Men will see our good work and glorify our Father in heaven. So our King is the light in us, His citizen. Our King is also the righteousness of His citizens. He is our righteousness. Him who knew no sin was made sin for us, that we can become the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. What a joy to the fact that the garment of righteousness that clothes us is the very person of our risen King, our Lord and our Savior. He's a King in heaven. He's also the King in our heart. We do not have two different kings. The King in heaven, sitting on the throne in heaven, God in Christ, is the very God that is dwelling in our heart. Oh, hallelujah. What He executes, what He carries out in heaven, He makes a reality in our different in our lives here on earth, the believers, according to His purpose and plans for our life. What a joy that we don't have a distant King. The Spirit of our King is in us. We can sing about it. We rejoice before God. We rejoice before our King that thank you for putting your Spirit in us. It's like, quote and unquote, the software, the operating system of God. God has installed it into us in the new creation. So the Spirit of our King is in us by virtue of the new creation. What a joy. The glory of our King is upon us. The beauty of our King, the radiance of our King, the effulgence of His glory, the brightness of His glory is upon us. That is the manifestation. That is wherever we come to, we are the aroma of our King, the living epistles of our King. What a joy of what He has bestowed to us in Christ. The power of our King is also in us. He is the power and the wisdom of God. So it's not just that He's executing power. He said, I give unto you power to tread upon serpents and scorpions. So the very power of our King has been given to us. And as we meditate on the word, as we become students of the word, as we fellowship with the Lord, the power content is made a reality in greater dimensions in our life. We co-inherit with our King. As we said earlier on, we do not have a remote King. This is one of the blessings of the new creation, that the King we have is not a King in heaven and we are here on earth. It's a King who is living inside of us and we are also living inside of Him. It's a very mysterious union. That's why we say there's no King like Christ. There's no King that lives in His subject and His subject are living in Him. It is humanly impossible. He said we abide in our King, we are in our King, and our King is in us. We are rejoicing, we are dancing. This brings confidence to us. It's not arrogance. It's just been worship coming from our hearts, praises, making melody in our hearts to the Lord that thank you, the possessor of the heaven and the earth is inside me as a redeemed, and I am inside Him as well. Same for you as a redeemed of the Lord. What a joy. We are in our King and our King is in us. We have an interceding King. We do not have a distant King. This is a King that intercedes for us until we are saved to the uttermost. It's not a King that is probably just leaving us to the folly of our own, is a king that intercedes for us day and night, night and day, so that the plans and purpose of God will become a reality in our life. What a joy to the kingship of our Lord Jesus Christ, an interceding king. Our king endures us. Our king endures us. We read this and we are grateful to God that you have not left us to be on the frolic of our own. Our king endures us. That is, for us to live is Christ. That Christ in us, the hope of glory. What a joy that our king endures us. A king who has never left us to fend for ourselves. Many times in certain situations, Israel had bad kings. They could care less about what was going on, the famine in the land or what have you. As long as the palace was good, they were good. But not such with our king. It's a king who has not left us, who has never, he said, I will never leave you nor forsake you. So he's a king that is able to relate and sympathize with our human weaknesses. The angels of our king are ministering to us. They are all around us. So the angels are servants of our king. They are everywhere. The continuous traffic between the heavens and the earth, ministering to us, the saints of God, as we stay in fellowship with our king. What a blessing. What a blessing to continue to maintain a life of fellowship and communion with our king, because his angels are ever ministering to us as we declare the word of God, as we stay in constant fellowship with the Lord. So the angels are of our king are all around us. What a confidence. The throne of heaven belongs to our king. Hebrews 1:8 talks about your throne, O God, is forever and ever, which the Father was saying to the Son. So the throne in heaven belongs to our king. It's a joy to know that, wow, my brother, the Lord Jesus Christ, your brother, our elder brother, our head, is the Lord in heaven. There's the king in heaven. What a confidence. So what on earth should keep us worried? That's why I say, come unto me, all you that live, and I'll give you rest. He said we should approach the throne of grace with confidence, with boldness. His dominion is an everlasting dominion, a dominion that is from eternity past to eternity future. It has no expiration, ever fresh, ever valid, not seasonal, not the seasonal dominion, but an eternal dominion. What a joy, what a joy. What else again? 1 Timothy 1:17, the anchor scripture. Now to the king eternal, immortal, invisible, to God who alone is wise, to be honor and glory forever and ever. Amen. To the king eternal, that is ever fresh, moment by moment. It doesn't have an expiration. Immortal, it is not something that is subject to mortality. Invisible, unseen to the naked human eyes. To God who alone is wise, that means every other person is foolish, be honor and glory forever and ever. Amen. What a joy. A king is mostly needed for the welfare of the people. Essentially, a king is to take care of the people, to protect the people from the enemy, because there's an enemy against any creature here on earth. Here. And so we find out that we needed a king in the body of Christ in the new creation, who is the very person of our Lord Jesus Christ. God has made his son to be everything to us in his salvation towards us. So we can see that we have a king who is protecting us, who is overseeing for our welfare, our total well-being. What a joy. Not just king over the human affairs, king over even Lord over the heavens, the visible and invisible, the principalities and powers, they are all being made subject to him. A king whose reign is eternal. His reign is eternal. It has no expiration. His reign over the humans, over the elements of creation, because he created them. There's no how the creature will be greater than his creator. So his reign is eternal, from everlasting to everlasting. The king we have, the Lord Jesus Christ, he heads the government of God. The government of God is upon his shoulder. He's the administrator of the economy of God. The office of the government of God is our king. That's the office of the Christ. He is the very person that has been anointed to carry out the details of the agenda of heaven over us, over the heavens and the earth. What a joy that our king, our indwelling king, heads and runs the government of God. What a joy. He's the king the whole world is subject to. The fish, the lion, the spirits, the humans, every one of them, they bow at the authority of our king. Everyone, because the earth is the Lord and the fullness thereof, and they that dwell in it. So our king, the whole world is subject to him. He's able to subdue all things under his control. Philippians 3:21. It is as the indwelling king, he does his work in our hearts. Without dwelling in us, he couldn't carry out his full heart desire, because His goal is to conform us to His image so that we'll become His expression, the expression of His kingdom here on earth. So it is as He indwells us that is able to carry out this work, this organic salvation of God in our life, so that we become His aroma, we become His light, we become His living epistles. What a joy that as the indwelling King, He does His work in our heart. A King who is able to sympathize with the human weaknesses of His people. Not many kings could relate with the weaknesses someone is going through. A subject could be going through situation, if they don't say it, even if they say it, if the king is powerless, it's one thing to be able to relate with the weaknesses of your people. It's another thing to have the power to change that situation, which we see in our King. In His humanity as the Son of Man, He can relate because He has gone through everything. There's no temptation we've gone through that hasn't come His way. And now, with His divinity, with His indestructible life, is able to help us and save us to the uttermost. What a joy. A King who is able to sympathize with His people's weaknesses. That's why I say we come boldly to His throne of grace. As King, He sits on the throne to make real His redemptive work in our heart. To make real His redemptive work in our heart. What a joy that as our King, He makes real His redemptive work in our heart. His substitutionary sacrifice on the cross was the basis, the foundation through which His work in heaven is being made real in our life. So as our King, His redemptive work is made real in our life. What a joy. He's making His kingdom a reality in our life so that we become the visibility of the kingdom of God on earth here. That's why when He came in His incarnation, He was inviting men that the kingdom of God is here. The kingdom of God is here. The kingdom of heaven has arrived. Come in. He was inviting people so that as they come to Him, we are now being made to be fishers of men. We are now being made to be conformed to His image so that we can become the expression of the kingdom. The kingdom will be a reality in our lives, in our families, in anywhere we go to, in the marketplace, in our nations. What a joy. Who is this? Our King is an unconquerable King. There is no king that hasn't been conquered under heaven. If humans did not conquer them, death conquered them. But this King that we have is the King that has conquered everything, including death, the key of hell and conquered Him. He has conquered everything. He's a King that cannot be dethroned. Indethronable. Indethronable. What a joy. There's no other King that has not been dethroned. If humans or a human system or spirit didn't dethrone them, death dethroned them, but not such with our King. Eternal, the same yesterday, today, and forever. A King who is one with God, dwelling in God, and God dwelling in Him. So the King we have is one that is dwelling in God, is living in God, is one with the Father, and the Father is in Him. What a joy that as God, Christ is our King. God is our King in Christ. God is our Father in Christ. Everything God is to us is through Christ. God is our Lord through Christ. God is our Savior through Christ. God is our Redeemer through Christ. God is our King through Christ. One with God, dwelling in God, and God dwelling in Him. What a joy. A King unto whom all owes its existence. Everyone, every creature, the snake, the whales, the lions, humans, in every the spirit, they hold their existence to our King. If He seizes their breath for a while, they are gone. So what a joy that this King, everything owes its existence to this our King. What a joy. It's one thing to have a King and not be, that's why this New Testament, the epistles, enjoin us to grow in the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. So in His multifaceted aspect as our Lord, our Savior, our Bishop of our souls, as our King, faith is arising and melody is coming from our hearts to the Lord. A King who has the preeminence in all things. The preeminence means He has the first place. And to have the first place in the economy of God, there's no room for second place. He has the first place. That's the final say in any situation. What a joy to the magnificence, the majesty of our King. The preeminence, the first place in all things. A King who laid the foundations of the earth and the heavens are the work of His hands. Hebrews chapter 1, 12, 13, that the heavens are the work of the hands of our King. He laid the foundations of the earth. All things were made by Him. For without Him was nothing made that was made. So we can see that visible, invisible thrones, dominions, all things were made by our King. He laid the foundations of the earth, and the heavens are the works of His hands. What a joy. A King who is mighty to save. A King who is mighty to help. A King who is mighty to deliver. A King who is mighty to help. I mean, marvelously. That is, it's not just giving help that is kind of maybe an ordinary help. That's mighty to save to the uttermost. Huh? What a joy, what a blessing. We could praise and give thanks to Him forever and ever for what a great King we have, a King that is mighty to save and to deliver, a King unto whom everything bows. Everything bows, everything acknowledges Him as Lord over the heavens and the earth. Everything bows, whether they know Him as their Savior or not, all were created by Him and everything bows to Him. A King whose name is above every other name. He has been given a name. Everything under heaven has a name. Every river, tree, country, person, spirit, sickness, circumstance, situation, every one of them has a name. And our King says, come unto me, all you that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Because His name is above every name. His name is above every other name. So He's been given a name that is above every name. And in that name, we have been baptized. What a joy. A King whose domain is limitless. Everything has a domain. A whale has his domain in the waters. The lion has his domain in the forest. The eagle has his domain in the air. Humans, we kings, presidents have their boundaries. They don't step into another country, territory, and want to exercise their kingship or their leadership or their headship. No, but for our King, His domain is limitless. Whether in the waters, in the heavens, on the earth, underneath the earth, every part of it, He fills all with Himself. What a joy to the resurrected Christ. Hallelujah. A King who upholds the universe by His word. By the word of His power, our King upholds the universe. Having created the universe, He now upholds it by the word of His power, as Hebrews 1:3 tells us. So, this is not a King that is only powerful in His territory and over His people, but a King that everything in the heavens and the earth have been made subject to Him. He upholds all by the word of His power. What a joy. A King over the nations, reigning over all the earth, reigning over all nations. Whether those nations have accepted Him as Lord over their land or not, He still exercises His reign and rulership over them. If we, the body of Christ, we only intercede more for those nations, because He operates on this earth here, principally through our intercessions and prayers. That's why we cannot afford to be a sleeping church. The more we intercede, the more the power of our King is made manifest here on earth. So He's a King over all the nations. This should encourage us to pray and intercede, because we know through our prayers, like Revelation 8 tells us, or Revelation 5 as well, that the prayers come as sweet incense to the heavens and an earthquake comes on the earth. As we bind on earth, our King is able to enforce His dominion and authority over the territory to bring the kingdom of heaven on earth. Psalm 89 portrays Christ as King possessing the entire earth. That is, Christ as the King that is the possessor of the entire earth. There is no other King like our God. A King who dwells in us as believers. This is the anchor part I'm looking at in today, that Christ is a King who dwells in His people. To me, this is what distinguishes Him the most out of every other king. There are a lot of things. He's King over the heavens and the earth. There's no other King that's ever over the heavens and the earth. But I just love this past. I could sit down and praise and worship Him. That thank you for being the King that dwells in us. Thank you for being the King that abides in us. Thank you for being the King, though, that is sanctifying us, transforming us, conforming us to your glorious image. There is no King like Christ. So today we've been able to look at Christ as the King eternal. We said He's the King eternal because His dominion is forever and ever. His territory is over the heavens and the earth. Psalm 89 portrays Him as King possessing all the earth. The earth is the Lord and the fullness thereof, and they that dwell in it. What makes Christ to be a King that no other King is because He has put His Spirit inside of us. He has made us partakers of His divine nature. The life of our King is in us. The Spirit of our King is in us. The wisdom of our King is in us. Our King opposes all things. His domain is limitless. Our King's It has a name that is above every name. Every name bows to the authority of the name of our King. Unto Him of our King, unto whom everything owes its existence. Everything bows. Everything exists. It is by Him He's able to save to the uttermost. Our King is mighty to save. He never turns anyone down that comes to Him genuinely for help. You could go to a king or a leader and they might want to help with all intention, but they don't have the power to change the situation, because what the person might be asking is beyond them. Someone could have a spiritual problem or a sickness and they go meet the president of their land. They're like, look, if it is a matter of money or position or something, I could pull it, but when it comes to this, I'm powerless. But not such with our King. He's the final destination of any situation that solves it. A King will lay the foundations of the earth, and the heavens are the work of His hand. He laid the foundations of the earth. All things were made by Him, for without Him was nothing made that was made. Who is this also our King? A King who has preeminence in all things. preeminence means that he has the first place, the authority and the final say in all things. What a joy to the preeminence of our King. There is no sphere of him and the devil that he doesn't have authority over. A King unto whom all owes its existence. Everyone, the young lions, everybody looks unto him for their sustenance. If he seizes anyone's breath, that is the end of that person. And this King is eternal, is immortal. A King who is one with God, dwelling in God, and God dwelling in him. A King who is one, who is the visibility of the Godhead, is the tangibility of the Trinity, is the reality of God to man. Everything God is to us is through the person of Christ, who is our King. What a joy to our King. An indethronable King, an unconquerable King, a King who is making his kingdom a reality in our life, making his kingdom a reality that we become the expression of his kingdom, the manifestation and the tangibility of his kingdom. A King who sits on the throne to make real his redemptive work in our hearts. What he died for as a man is now making it to become a reality in every part of us. What a joy to the kingship of Christ. A King who is able to sympathize with his people's weaknesses. What a joy that this is not a King that is remote to us. This is not a King that is distant from us, but a King who is able to sympathize with our human weaknesses, with our frailty. What a joy to this King. It is as the indwelling King, he does his work in our hearts. As the indwelling King, he carries out the full measure of his work in every part of our soul. What a joy. Is the King the whole world is subject to. Everybody in the heavens and the earth, they are subject to his rule, to his authority, and to his control. The whole world is subject to our King. He heads the government of God. The government of God is upon the shoulders of our King. He's the administrator of the universe. His reign is eternal. And now, to the King is mostly needed for the well-being of the people. And now, as we took our anchor scripture from 1 Timothy 1:17, now to the King eternal, immortal, invisible to God, who alone is wise, to be honor and glory forever and ever. Amen. There is no King like our King. There is no King like Christ, a King who died for us. Hallelujah to our Heavenly Father. Hallelujah to God the Son. Hallelujah to God the Holy Spirit. Christ is the King eternal. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah.